I'd rather run to than into the arms of Jesus Christ. Ah, hallelujah. You know, there are so many hurting people today. There are so many broken homes, broken families, and broken people today. But we have a loving God who is just ready to meet you right where you're at. I'm glad that's what he did for me. I'm thankful for the power of the Holy Ghost that can restore and revive and refresh and renew. And that's what he's longing to do as we end this year and we begin a new year. What God wants to do in your life is to refresh you, restore you, and make you into the person that he wants you to be. It's just a matter of allowing him to do it. I bless you this morning. Can you just thank the Lord today and just tell him right now, thank you, Jesus, for what you've done in my life. Thank you, Jesus, for the goodness of God. Thank you, Jesus, for salvation. Hallelujah, Jesus. We bless you this day. We glorify you. Hallelujah. When I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me up, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. Aren't you thankful for him today? When I situation is how I'll begin the next. So this morning, being your last opportunity for corporate worship, I want you to just think about all the things God has done in your life and where you are today. Church, we need to worship God in a new way, and that's my goal. I want to go out of this year worshiping and blessing God with you together. And I believe that we'll enter 2016 in a great, great way. So this morning, I dare you on purpose to worship the Lord today together with your brothers and your sisters here at Life Change Church. And all of you online, wherever you're at right now, just worship the Lord as we sing this again. When
This could be the last Sunday that you ever go to church. The last Sunday you worship God with God's people. I remember a number of years ago, I was sitting at lunch, I think it was Elder Todd, Elder Shannon, and a few others. And Todd laughingly said, "Pastor, man, you're eating like it's your last time." I said, "You never know, it could be." And this is the last Sunday of this year. This certainly is the last opportunity we're going to have to worship God together in 2015, unless you come back tonight. And I know that most of you don't. So I just want to say this is your last opportunity.
I just thought I'd throw that out there. That went over like a lead balloon. That made you about as happy as the rain does right now. But this could be your last chance. And I just want to ask you this. If this were your last Sunday in church, are you satisfied with how you've worshiped God?
Come on, preacher.
Now think about that a moment. If this were your last Sunday, I'll be honest, I'm not satisfied with what I've done yet. So I'm going to sing a little bit more. When I think about the Lord. Come on, think about what he's done for
how
you.
How he saved me.
Has he saved you? Why don't you worship him? Just lift your hands and praise him for salvation. Has he ever healed your body? Do you have any idea what he's done this year that you don't know what he's done?
He picked you up
and turned.
you and we praise you for your grace and your mercy. They've been our guiding lights this year, and we thank you for that. Thank you, God, that you've healed us even when we didn't know you healed us. You protected us at times this year that we didn't even know that you protected us. You got out on the freeway in front of us, and you took care of us, God. Even when we didn't even realize you were taking care of us. And we thank you. We thank you, God, for our family, our children. We thank you, Lord, that we are in this building this morning worshiping you when there's a number of places we could be right now if it hadn't been for your grace this year. You've saved us. You save us every day. And we thank you for that. I pray that you'll move upon our hearts today, that we would melt like wax before your presence, that each of us would be humbled in worship, that we would look to you, the Holy One of Israel, that we would trust you as we have this year in the coming days. As we close this year out, we pray that each of us, by faith, will close it on a high. We may not be high, but by faith we will close it standing on top of a mountain of worship today, praising you and thanking you for who you are and what you've done in our lives. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Let God's people say amen. 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 Give someone a hug next to you before you sit down. Look them in the eye and say, I love you so much. Would you take just a moment, please, and welcome our online congregation and thank them for being with us. Oh, wait. Please do a little better. Will you welcome our online congregation and thank God for them? Amen. We're so thankful for you that are part of our church each and every Sunday online. Many of you live in different places in the country, in different states. And we're so thankful. I'm even thankful for you that were well able. You could have got up today. You could have left the house. You could have come to church. But because of the rain, you stayed home but said, we don't want to miss Pastor Troy. And so you're online. And I thank God that you're with me as well. And I pray that what God does here, he'll do there. But with you that could have been here and just didn't, I pray that he'll only do half. I'm only teasing with you. But we're thankful for each of you that's part of our church. And like I said, some of you are here every single week. And we're thankful for what God is doing in your life. And I know that he's going to continue to move and continue to help you right where you are. Reach out to your friends and family and have them join us online as well. The online congregation is growing exponentially. And we're so thankful for that. Great things are happening. I believe even greater things are ahead for each and every one of us in the coming year. Ushers, I want you to get in place. We're going to receive the morning tithe and offering. And I ask that you would give as unto the Lord this last Sunday of the year. Give and worship him in your giving. Those in the congregation, those online, let's honor God through our gifts. Father, I pray that you'll multiply this offering to your glory, to your use. I ask that each of us will be faithful to do that which we know we should do, that we bring the tithe and the offering to you, and that you would open the windows of heaven and pour out your blessing upon each and every one of us. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Before I sing, the song I'm going to sing about talks about David and Goliath. And most of us know the story of David and Goliath and the ultimate result of what happened, how David slew the giant. But I was reading in 1 Samuel 17 this week. In 1 Samuel 17, 37, this is what really stuck out to me. Before he went out to fight the giant, David said, moreover, he was talking to Saul, moreover, the Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion, out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of the Philistine. Amen. And Saul said unto David, go, and the Lord be with thee. That ministered to me, because David already knew the power of God. And David already had experienced. And he thought, Saul, this is nothing. This is nothing. I've seen what my God can do, and he will deliver me. story of Paul and Silas, how they were bound and thrown into jail. They didn't worry, they kept on praying, for they were serving the God that cannot fail. When after midnight, God sent an earthquake, and all the foundations began to shake. Those prison doors flew open wide, and Paul and Silas stepped outside. He will deliver me in my time of need, like those Hebrew children from the fire he'll free. Like he fed 5,000 with two fishes and bread, and he walked on the water and he raised the dead. But he stood by Daniel in the lion's den, and he saved old Moses from Pharaoh's men. Open the eyes of the blind to see, I know that he'll deliver me. Well, it was David, my God delivered, when before Goliath he did stand. He took no armor, he took no weapons, just 5 stones and a sling in his hand. Then he was running to meet that army. He met that Philistine man who stood mighty and tall. He said, I come in the name of the Lord, and you know that mighty man did fall. He will deliver me in my time of need, like those Hebrew children from the fire he'll free. Like he fed 5,000 with two fishes and bread, and he walked on the water and he raised the dead. He stood by Daniel in the lion's den, and he saved old Moses from Pharaoh's men. Open the eyes of the blind to see, I know that he'll deliver me. Oh, he'll deliver me in my time of need, like those Hebrew children from the fire he'll free. Like he fed 5,000 with two fishes of bread, and he walked on the water and he raised the dead. Well, he stood by Daniel in the lion's den, and he saved old Moses from Pharaoh's men. Open the eyes of the blind to see,
song. Haven't heard that one since the Perry sisters sang it when I was about 8 years old at Wellston Camp. But I love that. I love that song. Revelation chapter 22. I'm reading from Revelation chapter 22, beginning at verse 17. Would you stand, please? Let us reverence the word of God. Revelation chapter 22 and verse 17. You think it'll rain? Can you even begin to believe these weather patterns? It's December 27th. I told someone before, I'd just soon have snow as to have this. Well, at least I know you're alive. Begin to wonder there for a minute. Revelation chapter 22, verse 17, and the Spirit and Bride say, come. Let him that heareth say, come. Let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life, and out of the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book. He which testifieth these things saith, surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. This is the last Sunday. I want to talk about some last things. Father, we thank you and praise you for your word. It is a lamp unto our feet, it is a light unto our path. I believe you're going to shine today clearly. And I pray that each of us will not only see the light, but that we'll faithfully walk in it and have fellowship one with another, and your blood will continue to wash us and cleanse us from all sin. Move on every heart and on every life. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. It is very obvious to each and every one of us, at least of us that are honest and look at the scene of which that's unfolding before us honestly. We know that we are living in the last days. I would dare say that we are living in the last of the last days. Yes, it's getting darker every moment. The sun is setting. Soon, the silver sheen will turn to mellow gold, then fiery red. That great ball of fire is going to take its plunge into a watery west to be extinguished for all eternity. Right now, the curtain is just about to be drawn, and the final act is being played out on the scene of humanity. We are living in the last days. Here we are, 2015, the last Sunday of this year. And I want you to know that just as sure as we are living in the last days, and just as sure as this is the last Sunday of this year, there are some last things. As you read the book of Revelation, I read some verses there, the final part of this book, as a matter of fact, the last verses in the Bible. And in these verses, you see some last things. First of all, you see the last invitation. He said in verse 17, the Spirit and the bride say, come. I want you to know that we are living in the last days, and right now the Holy Spirit is still moving, still active, still on the hunt, as it were. Right now the Holy Ghost is still convicting hearts and still drawing men and women to the foot of a bleeding cross. The Spirit of God, as some called him when I was a boy growing up over there in the hills, the hound of heaven, who will get in hot pursuit of a man or a woman's soul and pester them and not leave them alone until they are drawn so close to God that they can hardly get away. By the way, the only way somebody can be saved is if the Holy Spirit convicts them and draws them to Jesus. Jesus even said, no man can come to the Father unless he is drawn by the Spirit. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful one day the Holy Ghost called my name and drew me irresistibly with his love and convicted me almost so powerfully that I couldn't sleep and I couldn't hardly eat. I was so miserable where I was at because the Holy Spirit
made me such, to where I had to look to God. Thank God the Holy Ghost is still drawing men and women and boys and girls to true biblical salvation. He said the Spirit and the bride invite. Someone said to me, how do you know the Holy Ghost is still working? I said, because the church is still here. Amen. Inviting. Which, by the way, the work of the Holy Ghost is to call men to Christ and have them come and extend that invitation. If that's the work of the Holy Spirit, by the way, that should be the work of the church. To call men and women to Christ. You know, the church is doing a lot of things today, and all those things are important. Even our humanitarian deeds, they're important. The other things that we try to help people with, all of that is good. The counseling that the church brings, that's wonderful. All the things that we do as a church, they are important. But none of them are as important as the call of God upon our heart and life, moved on us by the Holy Spirit to extend an invitation to people. It is our work. The Spirit and the bride say, come. The Spirit and the bride. It is our job to invite people to Christ. Amen. It is our job to invite people to hear the gospel. It is our job to extend the invitation to those who are around us. And we have forgotten this somewhere along the line. But it is our job to carry a burden for souls. It is our job, our responsibility as Christians, to have a concern for people who don't know Christ. The Spirit and the bride say, come. Not just the job of the preacher to preach on Sunday and invite people to come to the altar. No, it is the heart of every Christian that should bleed with the same thing that the heart of God bleeds for. It is the movement of every Christian that we should have the same call upon our lips as the Holy Spirit has on His, to invite people to Christ. Not argue the Bible, not argue theology, not fight with people, not browbeat people. No, simply invite them to come to the well of water. Just the job of the preacher on Sunday morning. I remember a day when the bride, the church people, would carry a burden for souls. I can remember a day when people would have such a burden for souls, they would be moved by the Holy Spirit, and even in a church service, with their face bathed in tears, would go to someone and invite them to come and accept Christ. But we very rarely see that anymore. As a matter of fact, we very rarely even consider or think of our neighbor or the person we work with, our loved ones. Is it me or is the rain louder than you? Now, the last invitation in the Bible makes it very clear that whatever the Holy Spirit is doing, that's what the church is doing, the bride. And honestly, if there's no desire in our heart to invite people to Christ, you have to wonder, are you the bride? If the Holy Ghost job, if it's the work of the Holy Spirit to draw men to Christ, and there's nothing in us that longs for the salvation of souls, then we have to ask ourselves, and I don't say this to condemn, I say this to enlighten. It only makes sense. I'm giving you the last invitation in the Bible. This is the last time God says come. This is the last time. And He says in the last days, the Holy Spirit is going to say come, and the bride will do the same. The church will have a burden to invite people to Christ. He said, let him that is thirsty come and take of the water of life freely. Don't you appreciate the fact that God truly does satisfy the longing of our soul? He really does satisfy. I'm reminded of the lady who went to the well to get something to drink in John chapter 4. And Jesus met her there at Jacob's well. And he looked at her and said, if you knew who I was and the gift of God, then you would ask me for something to drink. And she said, you don't even have a bucket to reach down in the well. How are you going to give me any water? And he said, if you drink this water, you'll thirst again. But if you drink the water that I give, you'll never thirst. But the water that I give shall be in you a well that springs unto everlasting life. And this soul parched woman looked at Jesus and said, sir, give me a drink. I'm longing for something. Don't you understand? When he said, let him that is thirsty come and drink of the water, he was telling us that the field is wide open. Do you realize that everybody out there this morning inside, they are dying inside. They are hungry. Look at the wane in their eye and the wan in their voice. You can see it all over their personage. They are so thirsty. They are like a dying man walking off of a desert. They want something so desperately bad. And here we are. We know the answer. We have found the truth that Jesus Christ satisfies the longing, the deepest sense of desire inside of us. He quenches and slakes the thirst of our heart and the thirst of our soul. What makes a man? Go all the way to the end of that bottle. Night after night after night, what makes him do it? There's something inside longing. What makes the girl expose the vein and shove the needle in? I'm preaching something right now. There's something inside that's aching. The last invitation of the Bible says this, come and drink. It's the words of Christ. Look at them. There they are in John chapter 7, walking up the cobblestone streets of Jerusalem. In their hands are the golden goblets, the sanctified vessels out of the temple. And they're walking up chanting. And they take those vessels and dip them in the pool of Siloam. And they lift them toward heaven, chanting as they go. But yet they were so parched and spiritually thirsty inside. And Jesus was so moved. He lifted his voice among the swell of the crowd. And he said, if any man thirst, let him come to me and drink. And out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Amen. And John was quick to tell us he's talking about the Holy Ghost. Thousands of years later, a songwriter would sit with pen in hand and write, hallelujah, I have found him whom my soul so long has craved. Jesus satisfies my longing. Through his blood I now am saved. I'm drinking at the fountain where I ever would abide, for I've tasted life's pure river, and my soul is satisfied. There's no thirsting for life's pleasure, nor adorning rich or gay, for thank God I found a richer treasure, one that fadeth not away. Hallelujah! I lift my cup, Lord. Fill it up. Fill it with your grace. Fill it with your mercy. Fill it with your love. Fill me up, God. Fill me, God, with that which I know I need. Why live another day parched? Why chew on the husk that the pig have not eaten? Another day, when back at Father's house, there's plenty enough to spare. The last invitation, listen to me, hear me, listen, listen. There's coming a day very quickly that this will certainly be the last invitation. Have you thought about it? The day before Christ comes back, the Holy Spirit moving and calling, it's the last time. Have you considered it? The Sunday before Christ returns, the last time a preacher stands up and says, come to Christ. This could be that Sunday. This could be that day. That is the last invitation, the last time. Hey, every man and woman heard that last invitation at some point. It may not be the Sunday before Christ comes, but this might be your last Sunday. Do you hear me? I hope you're not in for a short service. I didn't get to preach last Sunday. The kids took over my pulpit. Little brats. Just teasing. Someone asked me, said, did you have a good Christmas? I said, I did. The kids got gifts and I got debt. No, this could be your last invitation. I'll never forget, young man, young preacher, 18 years old, and that night we preached. My nephew Rob was there. My friend Jay was there. Another guy was there from the college. Young lady sitting in the back, 13, 14 years old, a track star in that town. And God dealt with her. The Holy Ghost was convicting her and pulling at her and drawing her. She shook and trembled under conviction. Her knuckles were white as she held onto that back pew. Her friend said, oh, honey, why don't you come? Her mama said, oh, baby, why don't you just come to Jesus tonight? No, I went back and dealt with her. I said, why? Why would you turn Christ away? She said, not now. Another time. I'm not ready to come to Christ. Another time. But the very next day, after school, she's at the track running around. Around the track star. She gets about halfway around her first lap. Mama didn't know, she didn't know, nobody knew. The clot in her leg, it let loose, traveled her vein through her heart. Her heart stopped and she was dead before her face hit the pavement. You don't know when the last invitation will come. You don't know when the last time the Spirit and the bride will say, come, come, come. By the way, I want to say to you preachers, stop preaching foolishness. There are people that come every Sunday and they need to hear an invitation from heaven, not a bunch of pitiful trash on earth. They need to hear Jesus say, come. They need to hear the bride say, come. They need to hear the Holy Ghost say, come. Hear me. My God, wake us up. My God, stir us today. We're fooling around with a bunch of stupidity while the world's gone to hell. Men need to hear the call of the gospel. Come, come, come before it's too late. Come now, come. Today is the day of salvation. Now is the appointed day. Now, now. Tomorrow is too late. Tomorrow may never come. Next year may not come. It's the last invitation. You say, you angry? I'm not angry. I'm passionate. My God, we're fooling around with a bunch of foolishness today. That little girl, I cannot judge her soul. But I do know this. Sitting on that back seat, the Holy Spirit and the bride were faithful to call her to come. And she said no. I'm going to tell you something, children. I'm far from a perfect man. And I wish I was a better preacher than I am. But I can promise you this one thing. You'll not come to this church any Sunday that I don't give you an opportunity to come to Jesus Christ. I will not stand before God with that on my head. God, I got enough on me, but I won't have that on me. Let them all leave. I had someone some time ago, they said, we're just going to leave your church. And I said, why? They said, you preach the cross too much and you extend invitations and all that stuff too much for us. And I said, go on. I'm not going to stop. I'm not going to stop it. Huh? I prayed about it. The Lord said the last Sunday I'm allowed to preach an hour and a half. That's what he told me. He said that last night. Yeah, it was in a dream. It might have been the neurosis that I had before I went to bed. It could be that, but I don't know. You see the last invitation, let me give you this. You see the last warning that God gives. It's the last warning God gives in his Bible. He says, I testify unto every man that hears the words of the prophecy of this book. If he add to it, then the plagues that are in this book will be added to him. God says, let me warn you of something now. If you add to this, and by the way, this, I believe, now some scholar can correct me on this if they want, but I believe this is applicable not only to the book of Revelation, but to the whole Bible. And if I'm wrong, you correct me later, just not in front of everybody to embarrass me. Elder Shannon, Dr. Crooks, Elder Todd, you guys can convene and meet in conclave and tell me how I was wrong later, and I'll still think I'm right, but nonetheless. He said, if you add to this, then the plagues in this book will be added to you. Let me tell you something, God's not mocked. What he says here, he means. And then he said, warns us, if you take away from this, then God will take away your part of the book of life and of the holy city. Did you hear that? God says, if you add to my word or take away from my word, let me warn you. I'll add the plagues of this book onto your life, and then I'll reach. Now, I don't want to ruffle your theological feathers. All I can do is preach what the Bible says. He said, you're in the book of life, and I'll reach in and take your name out of the book of life. I ain't making this up. I'm reading it out of God's word. We must be careful when handling the word of God. And that is good for the preacher, and that's good for you too. That's why if you're a Christian, you better get in that book and know God and know his word, because you might be handing out advice and saying stuff that ain't God's word.
That's right.
Huh? Amen. And God says if you add to it or take away from it, amen. Keep it going, preacher. We're behind you. It is a stark, powerful warning. Don't you add to it. And don't you take away from it. I want to say this. I would not trade places as a preacher this morning. I wouldn't trade places with a lot of you guys out there that come on TV every week with a bunch of foolishness and add to God's word. I don't care how much money you got, that money won't take long to burn up in hell. I would not trade places with you for nothing. You say, are you judging men? I'm not judging anybody. I'm telling you, when you add to the Bible, you are in trouble. I don't care how many thousands of people smile when you talk, you are in trouble. There's plenty of things to preach in that Bible. You don't have to make up a bunch of stuff. The problem is, and I'll give you this, it's hard to take the truth and manipulate people.
That's right.
You come along with all this foolishness to get people's money. I want to tell you something, children. You can get mad at me if you want. But at least you can know when you die, you sat under a preacher that told you the right thing. And that stuff is not the right thing. Can I tell you what this whole book is about? You know what this book is about? It's about a cross. It's about a bleeding Savior. It's about mankind being lost and helpless without God, and God sending His Son to die in our place. That's the whole book. The Day of Atonement is not a money-making scheme. It is a picture of the cross. Huh? They say you got to observe all the calendar dates of the Jewish holidays and all that stuff forever. They're eternal in Christ. They're not eternal in that you keep them. You're only using the Day of Atonement to get money. I don't see you slaughtering any lambs out back, spilling blood and painting your doors. Huh? Do you do that? No! You use it to get money from people. Amen! I was watching one of them one day, and they said, if you get your money in on the Day of Atonement, it's a special day. It's a special day. I want to tell you something right now. My special day is every day. It's a special day. They said, get it on that day, and you'll have the seven blessings of Job. I called him and acted ignorant. Don't say nothing. I know what they're going to start singing. I said, I acted ignorant. They're going to start singing that, all I got to do is act naturally. I called him and I said, I am not going to have the money. I prayed and asked God to forgive me later. But I said, I'm not going to have the money until after the Day of Atonement. Can I do it then and still get the seven blessings? Because I really need those seven blessings. I want those seven blessings. I got to have those seven blessings. Could you please just make sure that if I just do it after the Day of Atonement, could I still have the seven? And the lady on the phone said, no, I think that if your heart was right, you could probably do that. She stuttered around a little bit. She said, I think maybe. And I said, but your preacher said that I can't. I got to get it on that day or I'm not going to have the seven. They're saying that's the special day, and you're telling me any day's special. Which one's right? And she had to admit that the preacher's right. And so I said to her on the phone, I said, now you're telling me this, that for a year I got to live with the cursings. And then next year on the Day of Atonement, I can give the offering and that year I'll get the blessing. She said, I reckon that's the way it's going to have to be. Have you ever heard such stupidity in all your days? Good night. I wanted to pray and repent right then and start preaching to her. Let me tell you something. You listen and you listen well. My Day of Atonement is Jesus. My feast is Jesus. It's all Jesus. My blessing, Jesus. Every promise in the Old Testament fulfilled in Him. Every letter of the law kept by Him. It is all Jesus Christ. And I will be blessed with the seven blessings and all other blessings in that book, not because I gave an offering on the Day of Atonement, but because I have faith in Jesus Christ. And He paid the price for me. He made the way for me. And my only hope, my only help, my only strength, my Jesus, 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 Jesus. Do you hear me? But what do they do when they do that stuff? They add to the Word of God. Now, do I believe in sowing and reaping? Absolutely. Do I believe in giving? Absolutely. Tithing and offering? Absolutely. But I believe it biblically. Huh? Amen, preacher. That's just one element. They add to it. What about all of us that take away from it? I really don't like that verse, so I'm just going to get rid of that one. Now, I don't agree with that. I'm just going to get rid of that one. And I'm not sure about this, so I'll just ignore that one. I wish it wouldn't have rained, because the rest of the people would have really liked this sermon. If it hadn't rained, they'd have been here and we'd have had real good service on this part. God sent me the crowd in the rain that don't like the sermon. Anyone that likes it? Norma. She's tired. She's got to take care of Elder Shannon the whole Christmas season. Open his presents for him. Now he says, if you take away from this Bible, you take away from my word. He said, I will take you out of the book of life. And that's strong. That is strong. The whole Bible, it doesn't, listen to me, it doesn't become God's Word. It is God's Word. It doesn't contain God's Word. It's all God's Word. And you can't ignore any of it. I was watching a guy, and they were interviewing him, preacher, and they said, "What do you do with this?" He said, we don't deal with that in our church." "Well, what about this?" He said, "Well, we don't ever talk about that." And they said, "What about hell?" He said, "We don't ever talk about hell." It's getting real quiet. Listen to me. Listen to me. What was he in essence saying? We just take that out. We don't want to deal with anything negative. Whew. I know I could have a lot bigger church if I'd stop this stuff. But you listen to me. You listen to me. We're not taking anything out of that book. Not a thing. Not in this church. No, not in this church. Not long as I'm the pastor. Not long as we got elders like this around. We're not taking anything out of that book. We're going to preach heaven and we're going to preach hell. We're going to preach judgment. We're going to preach righteousness. We're going to preach justice. We're going to balance the whole thing out. We're not taking anything out of that book. We're going to preach the fruit of the Spirit. We're going to preach the gifts of the Spirit. We want everything He's got. We're going to preach about holiness without which no man will see God. We're going to tell you, you got to be saved. You must be born again and Spirit baptized. You got to be filled with God's Spirit. And He will do that in an instant by faith. We're going to preach the whole book. Every bit of it.
Two, but I'm going to give you one just in closing to the last one. A lot of last things today. Some of you are looking at me like, this might be the last time I ever come here to preach. The last prayer in the Bible. The last prayer in the Bible. You know what praying is? One of the reasons why our prayers are powerless is because we pray irresponsibly. Right. Real praying is to hear the Word of God and get the revelation of God and pray back to heaven that which God is already saying.
Amen.
Do you hear me?
Yeah.
Listen, let me say that again. Real praying, we're haphazard. We just pray anything we want and ask God to bless it and do something with it. But that's not true praying. Real praying is out of a true relationship. Real praying is to hear what heaven says and say it back.
Right.
The last prayer in the Bible is this. Jesus screams, "I come quickly." And the prayer of the church back to heaven is to echo what he says by saying, "Even so, come, Lord Jesus." Praying back to heaven that which Jesus has already said. Do you know what I believe Jesus is saying right now? I come quickly. I come quickly. Regrettably, I don't hear much of the church saying, "Even so." Now, I just want to give you a piece of advice. Any of you that are dating, or if you intend on trying to find someone that will marry you. Any of you that are, right? Those of you online, those in the congregation, if you're dating somebody and it comes to that point of engagement and it comes to that point of talking marriage, can I just give you a piece of advice? If you're saying, "Marry me," and she's saying, "I don't know," move on. Let me say that again. If you got to ask her 15 times, move on.
If you got to convince her and beg her, move on. I'm not talking about after you're married. Then you beg the rest of your life. Don't leave me. Just don't leave me. You act like you don't know what I'm talking about. If your bride is late for the wedding day, cancel the wedding. And that goes for the groom too, ladies. If you got to try to trick him into marrying you, it's not worth it. Hasta la vista, baby. Years ago, now I might have been a little bit drastic. This was not Mandy. Years ago, I was just young and dumb. I was in love, thought she was in love. Had the ring, she's wearing the ring. We're a month away from getting married, and we're into it, fighting. And I said to her, do you want to marry me or not? And she hesitated that she didn't want to marry me. So I just took her hand, took that ring off her finger, put it in my pocket, and got in my car and drove away. You're looking at me like I'm mean. No, I didn't want to marry someone that was hesitant about being with me. I wanted someone that couldn't breathe without me. I wanted someone that was going to love me. Huh? I wanted someone that would choose me above everything. Huh? I finally had to settle and beg Mandy. I'm just teasing. I'm on real thin ice, aren't I? I better get to the point real quick, hadn't I? What's the point, preacher? Now, I might have been a little drastic, young and dumb. Might have been a little drastic. But the point is simple. Why would Jesus want to marry a bride that's hesitant about the groom coming?
Come on.
He says, I come quickly. I want my bride.
Yes.
And we're like,
That's good.
It's getting real quiet in this place. No, the real bride says, even so, Jesus, I've had enough of this old world. I don't belong here anyway. I'm sick and tired of sin and dealing with darkness and hurt and pain and sickness. I'm so tired of this old world. Come on. Just come on. Come and get me, Jesus. I'm ready to go. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. I remember a day when the church got excited about the groom coming. I remember a day we sang songs about it and shouted when we thought about Jesus coming back. But now, you know what the problem is? We love this world too much. We love this world too much. All right. It's 11:06. The last prayer of the real bride of Christ to say, come on, Jesus, even so. Come on, Jesus, even so. He gives the last blessing in the Bible. I want to read this last verse of the Bible to you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. It's the last blessing. He said, the grace of Jesus be with you. Amen. The grace of Jesus be with you. It's the last blessing in the Bible. Of all that he blesses and all the promises that he has, the last thing God says to us, my grace be with you. Now, why would he say that? Because it is his grace that enshrouds everything that he gives. His mercy is God not giving to us what we do deserve. His grace is God giving to us what we don't. And when he gives us anything in this book, any kind of blessing whatsoever, it is his grace upon us because none of us deserve any good thing. So he concludes the whole thing by blessing us. Listen, this is so good. This is the best statement of the sermon. You don't want to miss it. He concludes the whole thing by giving to us the whole thing. It is His grace that's given us everything in this book. My grace be upon you. The last invitation, the last warning, the last prayer, the last blessing on this last Sunday. Stand with me, please. Father, I thank you and praise you for each person that's here. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, I pray, God, that you'll move on every heart, on every life. What I feel so compelled to do today, God, is just simply do what you did in Revelation. I'm going to extend that invitation. The Spirit and the Bride say, come. I'm going to ask people to come to you. Every person in this place, God, that's lost, I pray that the Holy Spirit would deal with their heart right now. Every person that's headed for hell, I pray, God, that you'll get a hold of them right now. Every person that's running from you, I pray, Holy Ghost, that you'll touch their heart right now. Every person that's backslidden away from Father's house, I pray that right now, Holy Spirit, you'll deal with their heart. Every person that's running away from you instead of towards you, I pray that you'll get a hold of them right now. And that when we sing, there'll be an irresistible thing about your Spirit. And they'll hear the call that the bride is extending. Come to Jesus and drink of the water of life freely. May they come before it's too late. In Jesus' name, amen. Go ahead. If you need to pray, come. Why don't you come to Jesus? Just come on. Don't even hesitate. Come. Celebrated Christmas, just because you went to church, does not mean you're saved and going to heaven. Can I say that again? Just because you're here today does not mean you're right with God and on your way to heaven. If you could settle the noise of your life for just a moment and listen to the Holy Spirit deal with your heart, many of you would understand very clearly that if I die today, or Jesus comes today, I'm not ready. Now, I'm not saying that to try to scare you or manipulate you. It's not my job. It's my job to tell you the truth. How erroneous and how horrible would it be if you stood before God and you said, well, Troy, if you'd have just told me, I'm telling you right now. Many of you, the Holy Spirit is dealing with your heart, and you're going to walk out these doors lost, and you're headed to hell. If you don't get right with God, it's going to be too late one of these days. Because I do know this, every one of us is going to die. From a child to a 100-year-old man, none of us are going to live forever. We're all You say, Troy, what's your hope? My hope is faith in Jesus Christ. And I'm not ashamed to tell you that I believe his blood cleanses from sin. If you need to pray, I wouldn't even hesitate if I were you. Don't worry about being ashamed or what would someone think. I'm going to tell you right now, for all eternity, you'll be glad you listened to this preacher and you extended your faith toward the invitation that he's giving. Say one more time. Why don't you come?
Just as
thank you, Jesus.
I am.
Move in this situation. How about today? How about today? Are you coming? Continue to deal with the hearts of those that are right with you. That they'll be drawn. That they'll know that you love them. That you long to save them. I pray that each of us will understand there's going to be some last things happen. And may each of us answer the last invitation. Heed the last warning. Pray the last prayer. And receive the last blessing. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful day.